I do remember toward the end of primary school being taught how to multiply decimals by hand. It went something like, treat it like normal long multiplication, then count in the number of decimal places. This works, but no one ever explained to me what's going on, and looking back on it, it seems like making a mistake would be pretty easy to do. It wasn't until I was well and truly into my adult years that I became aware that, pedagogically speaking, treating the decimal point as something that can be moved around isn't really encouraged, because it removes us from the meaning of what the numbers actually represent. When we're faced with decimal numbers, there's a few issues that can make things tricky. First, we're dealing with numbers that we wouldn't usually have an intuitive feel for. Maybe my mind can picture there being 5 or 6 of something, or even 5.5 of something, but 5 and 63 hundredths isn't really a number I've got a good feeling for. So when we look at decimals, including calculating with decimals, one approach that's good to bring us back to the meaning of the numbers is to look at using estimation skills. In this example, I can't calculate 5 and 63 hundredths by 2 and 7 tenths in my head, but I know that it should be something similar to 5 or 6 times 3. So it shouldn't be anything like 152 or anything like 1.5. A second issue we can face, perhaps later on when using decimals in science or other areas, is that decimals can often be verbally expressed as a string of numbers with a point somewhere in there. So 5.63 or 2.7 or 1278.3419. Reading numbers in this way detaches the numbers from their meaning. So although it can be cumbersome, when we're first introducing decimals, it's better to reinforce the meaning as we would usually. So this is 5 and 63 hundredths and 2 and 7 tenths. Actually, it's in this way, and with our understanding of fraction multiplication, that we can make out why that counting in rule works. When we multiply these numbers, the first thing we're doing is actually multiplying 3 hundredths by 7 tenths. So it makes sense that this will produce some number of thousandths. We can forget sometimes that decimals often represent fractional components, tenths, hundredths, thousandths, and thinking in this way can help us see the connection between some fractions and their decimal representation. Why 2 tenths is the same as 1/5, why 1/25 is the same as 4 hundredths. But then a third issue that we can face when it comes to decimals is that often having just come to terms with fractions, we can start to get our intuition mixed up. We use denominator thinking and start to get the impression that 3 tenths is larger than 5 tenths because 1/3 is larger than 1/5. It can get especially confusing when some fractions don't convert to particularly nice decimals. 1/2 is okay because we can divide tenths perfectly into 2, and 1/5 is okay as well because, again, we can divide tenths into 5. But 3 causes us issues. We can't divide tenths evenly into 3, we can't divide hundredths easily into 3, we can't divide thousandths easily into 3, and so as a decimal, 1/3 becomes what's called a recurring decimal. That means that there's a sequence of digits that keeps repeating because there's no equivalent fraction with a denominator that is 10, 100, 1,000, or some other power of 10. If we think back to prime factorization and bring in the idea of multiplying a fraction's numerator and denominator to get an equivalent fraction of this form, when in simplest form, we'd need a denominator that only has either 2s or 5s in its prime factorization. In those cases, we can multiply by some number of 2s or 5s and get terminating decimals. In any other case, we'll have these recurring decimals. Obviously, we can never write out a recurring decimal completely, so we have to use new notation. This, and the need for calculators to round to the nearest 100 millionth or so, means that often there's a lot of confusion about what these numbers actually are and which fractions they're equivalent to. Any terminating decimal can clearly be expressed as a fraction, starting with the denominator corresponding to the place value and then simplifying if possible. There's a very neat trick involving just a little algebra that we can apply to convert a recurring decimal to a fraction. But then, while all fractions can be converted to terminating or recurring decimals, and all terminating or recurring decimals can be converted to fractions, there are some special numbers which, when represented as decimals, won't terminate and won't fall into a recurring pattern. I say special. Actually, there's infinitely many of these numbers, but some of them come up in interesting situations and have caused no small amount of fuss, because it was widely believed for a long time that all numbers could be expressed as a ratio of two whole numbers. As it turns out, the ratio of a circle's circumference to its diameter, which we call pi, is one of those numbers that can't be expressed as a ratio. Another one is the square root of 2, which would be the length of the long side of an isosceles right-angled triangle with smaller sides 1 unit in length. These are referred to as irrational numbers, which just means that, like we said, they can't be expressed as a ratio. Together with the rational numbers, they form the set of real numbers, or any positive or negative number that could be represented on a number line. So, this solves our mystery. The key to thinking about decimals is to remember that they're real, and so use estimation to help hone your intuition and attach meaning wherever possible.